rapturously. I mess with this level of perfection.
They deserve to die! All of them!
You used to be a time agent. Now you're some kind of freelancer.
That's a little harsh. I think of myself as a criminal. I met a soldier in a bar. Long story.
How was that?
Strictly professional.
I clapped you 2 miles of ventilation shafts, chasing life signs out of this thing, and who do I find? Mickey Mouse!
I'll just make you come up here and stand like this.
All day. Anyway, so the room's very, it's kind of like short and stubby. Why are you laughing? I'm not used to short and stubby. I'm used to long and thick rooms. Oh, I love you. You're gonna be good today, I can tell. You're gonna be good today. How are you, sweetheart? I'll get to you later. You're good? Just you wait. You're gonna be sweating in places you've never sweated before. Now, I apologize if I hack up a lung, because I have had a bit of a chest infection. I know. That's what happens when you smoke crack cocaine. Oh, how do you sign crack cocaine? Really? That looks like you're smoking a vagina. Right? See, if I were signing and making up my own sign language, this would be my crack cocaine. It'd be like this. Thumbs up from a deaf person. I'm gonna rewrite the sign language, all right? Well, think of that. So, like I said, I'm going to London on a Sunday. Scott's already gone ahead, and he's visiting some friends before I get there, ones that I don't like. tell me the truth. Anyway, so I was back in London a couple of months back, and I went back. How many of you follow me online? How many of you don't? Well, that's not the majority. People didn't put your hands up. This is interactive here. How many don't follow me online? Come on, be honest. You're not gonna get booed. I'm just gonna kick your asses. Seriously, if you don't follow me, you should. And here's a story why I'll tell you you should. How many saw my jacuzzi video? How many didn't? You guys suck at the didn't part, you know what I'm saying? So I'm in the jacuzzi, and I'm sitting in the jacuzzi, and I'm doing a Facebook Live, and I'm sitting going, hey everybody, I'm in the jacuzzi, I just wanna let you know what's coming up in the week, and blah, 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 because I do all these random videos. And I'm talking away, and all of a sudden behind me I hear, sploosh. And I turn around, and there's my husband Scott, sitting in the jacuzzi, completely naked. And I said, did you just walk behind me while I was doing Facebook Live? He went, yeah. I said, you were naked? He's like, yeah. I'm like, you were totally naked? He's like, yeah. I just saw Jungle Book, I loved it. I'm like, screw Jungle Book! You just showed like 4 million people live on Facebook your penis! And he went, so I left it, right? And I get all these tweets from and messages from newspapers and from magazine things and saying, is John Barrowman exposed his husband's genitalia online? I'm like, I didn't freaking expose it. He took it out and walked behind me. So they're saying, do you have any comment? I'm like, it's big. And they're like, no, we need a comment. I'm like, well, that's the comment. They said, but aren't you ashamed? I said, no, nothing to be ashamed of there. Why do you think I'm always happy? They're like, no, Mr. Barrowman, we need a quote. I said, I'm giving you a freaking quote. You don't want to hear that. I said, I am not apologizing for having my husband husband and myself nude in our own backyard, in our own jacuzzi, and I will not apologize for that. It was an accident. So I think, no story, right? Wrong. So I go over to England. Facebook by this time have taken it down because you're not allowed to show nudity on Facebook, right? Tell that to some of the porn actors. So I go to London, and I'm in London, and Scott's back in the U.S. And when I'm in London, I always go see my in-laws, as you should, right? Sheila and Sterling, my mother-in-law and father-in-law. So I'm at Sheila and Sterling's house, and I'm sitting in the afternoon, and we're in the conservatory, sitting, having tea, crumpets, scones, strawberry jam, raindrops on roses, and whiskers on kittens. And cucumber sandwiches with the crust cut off. It's all very English. And I'm having tea, 4 o'clock. Tea time! And I'm about to take a sip of tea, and Sheila turns to me and she says, John! That's how my mother-in-law talks. Jackie said,
yes, well, Jackie called this morning. She said, Sheila, have you seen the internet today?
I wouldn't mean internet.
She said, yes, the internet. She said, I said, no, Jackie, I haven't seen. Sterling hasn't shown me anything on the internet today. And she said, Jackie said, well, Scott's cock's all over the internet.
I'm made sip, I go, excuse me?
She said, yes! Apparently, Scotty has got his cocky out all over the internet! And it's made the news!
I went, well, Sheila, she said,
you know, John, I do wish you'd tell Scotty to keep his cocky in! And not out!
This is a conversation I'm having with my mother-in-law over tea! I feel like I'm gonna vomit! And at that point, my father-in-law, Sterling, walks in the room. Sterling, sweater, cravat, trousers, beautiful shoes. It's 100 degrees outside. He walks in and goes, yes, well, I've heard the same thing, but apparently he's very well hardened. So if you don't follow me, you're missing out on my life, because it's a really fabulous one, let me tell you. All because of you guys, by the way. Thank you very much. I've still to get to you, girl. Are you switching with somebody? Are you? Where's the switch hitter? Oh, you're tag teaming today. Love a bit of lesbian action. So do a lot of these people. Even the straight ones. Look at the guy behind you. Alexander Hamilton's nodding. Yeah, we know your history, buddy. Angelica, Eliza, and Peggy, Skyler's sisters. Really, I do not do drugs. I've spilled on this mic. It's a little wet. Do what you please. So what I like to do, as you know, if you've been to any of my panels before, I really like to feed off of you guys. So if you have any questions, we have a microphone gentleman, a very gorgeous microphone gentleman standing there. He's got great arms. Show me your arms. No, don't be shy. You know what? You're going to have to come further down the front because I have, mine are usually very long. I mean the lines. What's your name? Gordon. Gordo. Gordon's gorgeous. Look at Gordon, everybody. I know. If you touch him, I will kill you. Nice big line. Great, you're gonna stand there the rest of the day. I'm just kidding. I was gonna make a really bad joke there, but I won't. So what I like to do is let you guys ask the questions. I kind of feed off you, because that's how I roll, and I think it, you know, gets to let you know me a little bit better, and all that kind of stuff. If anybody's interested, though, tonight, I'm doing a little private event. If you come to our table, there's flyers. The only charge is that I have to cut. It's nothing to do with the con. It's going to be a more intimate thing like this,
and much more raunchy.
No children allowed. You're like, no children allowed, you should take the children out here. You'll be driving home, they'll be like,
what did he mean when he said cookie?
Dad will be like, shut up, ask your mother!
No!
Happy trails. It's a long trip back to Saskatchewan. When you're not on WestJet. Let me go with the first question here. Yes.
Hi, so recently at San Diego Comic-Con, you dressed up as Squirrel Girl, one of my personal favorites. I was wondering what your thoughts were on her and whether you made the costume yourself.
I love her bushiness, her tail. What are my thoughts on her?
Yeah, like, what is it about her that you like?
She loves nuts just like me. Right? She's a squirrel. I love my cashews. And my really big macadamias. I did it because I was hosting the Eisner Awards, and I figured I wanted to do something a little different. And, you know, most people, when they present shows, they, you know, who are you wearing? I'm wearing Giorgio Vaclami, and I'm wearing, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I want to be like, who are you wearing? I'm freaking Squirrel Girl. And then the next one, who are you wearing now? You know, I'm Harlequin. I wanted to represent what the show was about. Geeks and nerds. And I'm a geek and nerd. And I know some of us geeks and nerds, we do get dressed up, but the whole point, not in Armani suits or whatever, it's cosplay, bitches. So the promoters were like, cosplay? I'm like, yeah, I'm really gonna cosplay. We paid $800 for the Squirrel Girl outfit, I'm not freaking wearing it. So yeah, I did. That's why I did it. Because I wanted to show the Eisner Awards and Lionsgate, who were, you know, producing it at Comic-Con with us, they were totally behind it because I'm like, this is what it represents. I mean, Squirrel Girl is up for one of the awards. So why not represent it? Same as, I did Zap Brannigan. You know, Matt Groening was up for an award. And what's great is I've dressed as Zap before I introduce him. Didn't even know that he knew who I was. And I walk past him and he goes,
Barrowman, I love you.
And I'm like, ah! Ah! Well, then why don't you put Captain Jack on The Simpsons? I didn't. Anyway, is that okay?
Yes,
sit your ass down though, thank you. I'm gonna sit like this, I'm gonna be like Oprah. Where's Gail? Go ahead. Nobody got that.
Less fun questions, but I was wondering...
Sit down then. I'll make it more fun.
I was wondering if you had any...
That's not my leg, by the way. What?
For young actors and actresses.
Do I have any advice?
Yeah. Like, how to start out, what should you do when you're starting out, kind of thing.
If I had the advice that would work, I'd be a gazonkadillionaire, right? How old are you?
I'm 15.
15. Great. Let's just cross my legs there then. Cross yours too. There you go. I don't want anything signing that's not supposed to be moving. How do I say this without pissing people off? If you really want to do it, commit to it. Like anything in life, ask acting is the same. If you have a desire to do it and you really want to do it, commit to it. Don't do it half-assed and then go, oh, I don't understand why it's not working. If you commit to it and it doesn't work, then you can say at least you've tried, right? That's with anything in life. So also do it because you want to do it, because you may have other people in your family who are going, you're not doing that, da da da. Whose life do you want to live, yours or theirs, right? You want to live yours. I'd say get the training, study. When my counselor, when I was 17, 18, and they pulled me into the counselor's office in high school, and they asked me, you know, because they did that, I don't know if they still do that now, but they did that back then, and they sat you down, and they went, so, what do you want to do with your life? And I said, I want to be an actor. They went, no, really, what do you want to do with your life? And I went, I want to be an actor. And they said, no, let's stop playing games. What do you want to do with your life? I said, I want to be an actor. And she went, no. She said, you need something. I said, Miss Boswell, that was her name, right? Shame. I said, you're out. She said, something realistic, something that you can earn a living from. I said, hold on, Miss Boswell. You're sitting there as a mother of an Olympic athlete, a basketball Olympic athlete, and you're telling me not to go for my dreams? And there was silence. And she said, well, what will you fall back on? And I went, my ass. And I got up and I left the room. And I didn't have anything more to do with it. And I went and I committed to what I wanted to do, right? Because I thought, I'm going to prove her wrong. You got to work hard. You got to commit to it. Don't do it as a hobby, okay? So get the training. It's the most important thing to do. And then when you do get a job, know your lines, be on time, and hit your mark. And don't waste anybody's time, okay? That's the advice I give you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Hello there.
Hi. And if you do go into those counselor meetings and you are 15, 16, just because you think you're younger than them and they're sitting behind the desk doesn't mean they know everything. Right? So stick to your guns. I love a little bit of controversy in Canada. Yes.
So
you're excited.
You play the
Look, I have my own water girl. Watch this. Steve, watch her follow me. No, see if you can do it. Ready? Go all the way around in circles. There. That's okay. I like my fingers a little wet. You know, what's written on your back is an infection. Staff, get it? I'm on a roll today. Yes, go ahead.
Wait. So when you played as Black Arrow on the Arrow show, how did...
Dark Archer. We have to be careful with our words now. African American archer.
Okay, so how did it feel playing as Dark Archer?
How did it feel playing the Dark Archer?
Yeah, like when you first started out, like...
Frickin' awesome. Amazing. And the first time I came to do some, I came to shoot in Vancouver, and I'm just talking about working, nothing else. You gotta stick with me, people. I'm quick. I'm testing you when I do that. I'm not too quick, honey. Don't you worry, Harlequin. I'll go slow for you, bitch, okay? Suicide Squad any day. Bam! So I went up to Vancouver to film for the first time, and when I put the outfit on, and they gave me all the outfit, and it's like six layers, with a turtleneck, and it was full turtleneck sleeves, and then a thing on over an oriental jacket, and then the leather, and then they gave me the hood, then they gave me a gimp mask, and they covered my mouth, and when I talked, it sounded like that, and I couldn't breathe, and I'm claustrophobic. I had major panic attacks, and I'm like, oh my God, I can't do this, and I had to talk. a huge speech while I kicked the crap out of Oliver Queen, and I kicked him through a wall, right? So I'm doing the sequence, and this is like the first time I've really met Steven on set. I mean, apart from seeing him otherwise and watching videos of him online while I've been at home privately. I love Toronto, boys. So I'm doing the sequence, and we've been filming a little while, and then this is the sequence at the end of the night. It's like 4 o'clock in the morning, and I've got to do the sequence where I jump out of the rafters down, and I have the fight, and I punch him, and I kick him, and I push him through the wall, and then I'm supposed to stand over him and say, while I'm kicking him, I'm supposed to say a speech. Like, guys, there's no point talking, you're just gonna dub it. And they're like, no, we need you to do it because it'll give everything, you know, action. So I'll give you the action. Like, fine, I'll do it. Sweating, panicking. And it was rush, 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 rush. And I get to the sequence and I kick and I boom and I go up to him and I start kicking him like this and like this. And on the third kick, I went bam and I kicked him in the shin with my Harley Davidson steel toe cap boots. I was sweaty and I was panicking and I was nervous, and he got up and he went, ah, nah, 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 nah. And I walked over to him and I went, Steven, I'm so sorry. I said, I've never kicked anyone in my life in a fight. This is the first time, except the nose that I broke of the stuntman in Torchwood, but I've never kicked anybody. Please forgive me. He's like, you're fine. You're fine. I said, no, I've been kicked before. You want to kill me right now? Just do it. Mortified. To this day, he's never let me forget it. When we do a fight sequence, he just goes, watch my shins. So that was my first day. But from that point on, love every minute of it. Thank you. Next one.
In Arrow, what do you think about Malcolm Merlyn just kind of suddenly appearing everywhere, just randomly? Like, it's like no doors around, he just appears.
What do you think about it?
I think it's hilarious.
I'm gonna kill you. Just wait till tonight when you're in your room and I pop out of your closet. And it ain't gonna be with a feather boa. Protect your shins. I like that Malcolm steps out of the darkness because he's a magician. Nobody then knows where he's coming from. But what I'd like them to explore more is, where was he before he came out of that darkness? What's he been doing? Also the fact that when he does come out, don't just have him say, you're wrong. Like in that episode of The Flash, where I just walked forward and said like 4 words. I'm like, what? Oh yeah, your presence. I'm like, my presence? I need to take a dump. That's what my presence is right now. So I do like the way he just appears, because everybody comments on that. They're like, oh, I saw so-and-so walk past the dumpster in the show. I was expecting Malcolm to come out. Malcolm will never come out of the trash. Because he's not trash. However, me on a Friday night, I'll come out of a dumpster anytime. Quick, 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 quick! Thank you. I didn't answer your question, but who cares, right? Yes. It was a stupid question. Anyway, I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding. Just protect yourself tonight, honey, because I'm coming.
Question for you.
Ooh.
So as Captain Jack Burke,
Doctor.
You've kissed and made out with a lot of people.
Uh-huh.
We are all dying.
Half of this room.
So, out of everybody, who's the best kisser?
Okay, let's be like Fraulein Maria. Let's start at the very beginning. Just wait. Christopher Eccleston was lovely to kiss. That was a very romantic kiss that showed the relationship between Jack and the Doctor and Rose and the Doctor. That's why I kissed both of them exactly the same way, with the same kind of passion, with the same kind of enjoyment, because it was about love. It wasn't about sex, okay? However, when I kissed David at Comic-Con, that was totally about sex. And he was not expecting my tongue in his mouth. But when I felt on his trousers, he expected it. He had a phone in his pocket, everybody. A David 10-inch phone. Did I answer that one? Good for you, girl. Now you go home and enjoy. How old are you? 24. You go home and enjoy yourself tonight, girl. Have a glass of wine. But just don't be in that other girl's closet with me, all right? Because I'm not into it. Yes, you don't know how hard it is to not cough when I laugh. Yes.
You do a lot of theater work. Any dream role in theater that you haven't played yet?
Shut up. There's a lot of roles that I haven't played yet that I'd love to play. And I'd love to play Mac and Mabel. You're like, what's that show? One person raises their hand. You are such a theater. You're a girl, but you can still be a gay theater person. I don't know. I don't really think of things in that way. I mean, I would love to do something in the biggest, hottest musical at the moment, but I'm not a rapper. However, I do look good in a crown. And I have been honored by the Queen, so I am, you know. Anyway, so I'd love that. Yeah, there's tons of stuff to do that I would really like to check out. But that was my way of getting around your question, because I don't really have the answer for it. Do you guys get SiriusXM here?
Yeah.
You do. Do you get the Broadway channel?
Yeah.
Do you all know the amazing Seth Rudetsky?
Yeah.
Three people. Thank you very much. You know, I love listening. I've started to get to know Seth, and he's he asked me if I would do his musical, Disaster. They're going to be doing a presentation of it in London. And also, in fact, this coming weekend, I think it is this weekend, if Kelsey's back there, there's a musical that I did. Excuse me, just burped. There we go. I feel so much better now. Just wait till I fart. Soon, and hopefully they might do that as a show, but I'm too old to play the role now. I was 20 when I recorded it, like my early 20s. So yeah, but just all I'll say is watch this space. Follow me on Facebook, watch this space. Thank Something you. Might be coming.
Thank you.
Yes. Keep them coming, kid. Don't stop. You're breaking the flow.
First of all, I love you so much.
Thank you.
I want to know if there's any actors you haven't worked with that you'd like to work with in the future.
No. No, I don't think of things like that. I'm one of those actors that if I'm given a job and I go to do it, there might be, like, for instance, when I was doing a show called Titans, and you probably won't know who this is, but Victoria Principal, from Dallas. Victoria was, I'm sitting in Eric Spelling's office. He was a big producer in the 80s and 90s, dead now. Well, he is! And I did a show for him, and I'm sitting in his office. And I had my mom on the phone with me, my mom and dad, and I'm sitting in his office, and I said, Mom, Dad, Mom, he's going and he's getting me lunch. His office is like a house. He's getting me lunch, and everybody's here, and all the people who are playing the guys. I said, but they're having us all sit around because they're going to introduce us to the woman who's playing our mother. And my mom went, no one can be a mother like I am. I said, I know that. But somebody's going to play my mum. I said, and she said, well, keep me on speakerphone so I can hear when they announce it. And Eric Spelling walks in, he goes, John, that's how we talked. John, I want to introduce you to the woman who's going to play your mother. She's really great, she's awesome. Everybody meet Victoria Principal. And she walked in the room like that, and I went to my mom, she was awesome. So it's things like that, when they happen, I am really excited about it. Have I ever told you my George Lucas story? No? Too bad. Anyway. I was at the Cannes Film Festival, and I was doing The Lovely, a movie that I was in. And I was asked to go and sing at Cannes and all this stuff. It was awesome. Robbie Williams had to pull out. Now you're with me. So they gave me his hotel room, his budget. So rather than me spending it on stupid stuff, the night after the big party, I invited all of the cast members around, like the dancers and the crew and people who would normally get to party, back to my hotel room, and I spent Robbie Williams' budget on the best party ever. But at the party before, I'm standing with Natalie Cole. Ooh. Drop that name. And I'm standing there, and I'm like, she's like, who are you looking at? I'm like, over there. She's like, what? I said, Natalie, it's George Lucas. She went, well, go talk to him. I went, I can't go talk to George Lucas. She said, you can go talk to George Lucas. I said, how can I go and talk to George Lucas? She said, you're standing with Natalie Cole. You can talk to anybody. You think so? She said, yeah, just go do it. I'm like, I'm really nervous. She said, you don't have to be nervous. You're gorgeous. Just go talk to him. I'm like, I don't think he's gay. Too bad. He'll love you anyway. So I got mustered up my energy. George, listen. I know. George, I love you. George, look, I just love you because you know Chewbacca. Natalie, I'm so embarrassed. She said, what did you? I said, I just totally embarrassed myself. I just went, George Lucas, Star Wars, Chewbacca, I can't go back. She said, you go back over there and talk to him. Mr. Lucas, kid, shut up. I get it all the time. I know. You're a fan. I love you. No spoilers. Nice to meet you. I went, yes! I had wanker written all over my forehead. Yes?
Hi, John. I'm a big fan of Doctor Who. I was just wondering...
Did you say Doctor Pooh?
Yeah.
Doctor Pooh.
Doctor Who.
Oh, okay, got it.
Sorry.
There is fan fiction.
You play with Christopher Eccleston, Matt Smith, oh sorry, not Matt Smith, Dave Tennant. I was just wondering, because of your leaving, would you like to work with Peter Capaldi?
Because of who leaving?
Because you left Doctor Who.
I didn't leave Doctor Who.
The
doctor left me on a frickin' planet. Obviously you weren't paying attention. I spent decades and centuries trying to find the doctor. I even started Torchwood. Because the 21st century's when it all changes and you gotta be ready. I was ready. I had his hand. But did he come back right away? No. Is your Vijiji talking again? I love it. How do you do that, your Vijiji? Oh! So now I can do duck face, right? How was that? Someone lied to me. How do you do duck face? Is it duck face? Yeah? You show it. Well, I can't really show that. I don't have that. The Gigi. Talking booty. Distracting, sorry. I've never been asked back. I know. But, yes, there is. But there's someone who's in charge at the moment. For some reason, that person is the one that might be blocking some people's return. Wait. Love you. Are also blocking the revamp or bringing back of a show called Torchwood. Oh, wow. Apparently. But I'm gonna try to, you know, I can't do much about Doctor Who, but for Torchwood, I'm going to put up the biggest screaming, shouting, tantrum fight because I know. People love that show, and I even have producers that I've met with in Los Angeles who say, how can we bring Torchwood back? And I say, get rid of someone's ego. So when things are discussed, and if maybe some people do like petitions or email the BBC, like, every 30 seconds, and they have to answer every email, it all gets logged, you know what I'm saying? Send. Maybe they'll get the hints. But I am going to meet with Chris Chibnall. I'd love to take him out to lunch and talk to him, so listen. It sounds weird when it comes from me because I don't want it to sound like it's somebody who's like petulant because they're not being asked back, right? If it never happens, it never happens. But I am part of the world, this world, your world. Captain Jack was nominated the second most popular companion in the world by the Whovians and other people next to Rose Tyler. Can you imagine if River Song and Captain Jack were back? playing the doctor, they would wet themselves. And we would all watch. So who knows what's going to happen in the future, but I would love to be a part of Doctor Who again because Captain Jack changed my life. I'm a fan of the show, I love the show, and it would just be totally freaking awesome. Thank you. Yes?
So I'm a huge fan, by the way.
And you're standing with your hands on your hips.
And I'm wondering who inspired you to become an actor?
Nobody. I'm telling you the truth, nobody inspired me. It's just always been in my core. When I was a little boy and I saw a girl called Lena Zavaroni, and Lena Macaroni, we used to call her. Lena Zavaroni on a show called Opportunity Knocks, which was like the British version way back in the 70s of America's Got Talent, right? And Britain's Got Talent. It was called Opportunity Knocks, and Lena Zavaroni came on. And she was about this high, and she was a dynamo. She came out and she went, "Mama!" Like that big, right? And I was like, oh my God, this girl can sing. And every gay gene in my body just opened up. Because in the playground the next morning, I was going, "Mama, he's making eyes at me." That's how this girl sounded. So from that point on, I knew I wanted to be an entertainer. And entertainment led to singing and dancing, and then that led to, the television world. And I think singing and dancing is acting anyway, so it's all combined into one. And I've got people that are growing up I watched, like Gene Kelly. I loved watching Gene. My gran used to sit with me late night and watch old Gene Kelly movies on television and old 40s musicals. And I got to meet some of those people over the course of my career. So no one really inspired me, but a lot of people I watched kind of played a part and kind of influenced kind of who I am today. Yeah? Okay? Thanks. Yes.
Nick, thank you.
Hello.
Now this is a throwback.
Wait, where's my phone? Put your hand. I was gonna catch you. I got busted the other day. I was on the plane. Leaving Los Angeles. Palm Springs, and I'm going down the runway. You meant to have your phone off, right? But there was a Pikachu on the runway. And I had to get it. And I'm sitting in the front going. And the plane's starting to hurtle, and the Pikachu's getting further away. And the flight attendant says, "Could you turn your phone off, please?"
Sorry.
Back to Torchwood.
Thank you.
Are there any scenes that you filmed that never actually got aired?
Oh,
that you,
yeah.
That you love? Can you please share?
No.
Please?
Come to my event tonight, I can share those ones. No, I don't. I don't really know. Most of the scenes that weren't put on were put on the DVD extras, so you can see those. There's no really kind of like outrageous scenes. I mean, except when I was probably naked. Shut up. There was one sequence within Eve and I hope I haven't told this story before. Eve and I were filming, and Gareth, we were filming a sequence where I was in a greenhouse with Gareth, and we're making out, right? And Gareth, who plays Yanto, and Jack and Yanto are supposed to be making out, and I'm supposed to be hands all over and rubbing him in ways that I'll just do this, that you're supposed to rub, right? Because he had an itch on his back. Except his back was the front, and you know, I've never known back to front. I've always gone for the back. Anyway, you're with me now. So we're filming, and Eve's supposed to walk in, and she's supposed to interrupt us. So I say to Gareth, "Are you okay? I'll just put my hand on your thigh." And when we're filming, and we'll move, and I'm very conscious of doing it with guys who are not gay, right? And to make them feel comfortable, as I am with when I kiss women. Making them feel comfortable. You should always make the person you're kissing feel comfortable. Okay? So I'm kissing and I'm going, and we go, "Action!" And I go, "Oh." And Eve walks in, she goes, "Ah!" Cut! Do it again. Okay, and ready, back to one. And action! Eve walks in, she goes, back to lunge, cut, do it again.
Here we go.
And action. Eve walks in. So like 10 takes later, she's still laughing. Take 11. Let's do this again! And action! She walks in, she goes, I go, please! Gareth, I'm sorry. We gotta do it again. Fine, I said, I'm sorry. I'll keep rubbing your leg. I must be sore by now. And he says, that's not my leg you've been rubbing.
I love my job. I love my job.
I used to be a speed skater. Thank you. You're welcome. Yes.
Hi, John.
Hi.
My question is, in regards to as your role within the Arrowverse grows, and given that Supergirl will be having a musical episode next season, how likely it is...
I don't know if that's fact yet.
I
don't know.
I don't know. Well, regardless, how likely is it, do you think, that Malcolm Merlyn will get in on the fun?
I have no idea.
No idea?
Nope.
No?
No, maybe you should. If Supergirl does do a musical episode, of course I would love to be involved. Because it's part of, musicals are a huge part of who I am and what I have done. And having a 13 year career prior to being in television, of doing all the biggest musicals around the world, Andrew Lloyd Webber, Cameron McIntosh, Stephen Sondheim, who I know, you know them all by name and friends, it would make sense. But I have no control over that, so it's up to them. Welcome. You see my face? I'm like, that's up to them. Yes.
Hi, Mr. Merriman.
Hi, call me John, not Mr. Merriman, unless you want me to spank your ass.
You'll have to talk to me.
What's your name?
Armand.
Armand. See this? And Armand's still smiling.
My best moment in the panels ever.
Best moment ever. Stay with me. What was your question, by the way?
I forgot now.
I have that power.
Forget the question.
Forgot the question. You obviously enjoyed it, I can see.
Very much.
I need a drink.
Yeah.
That's vodka. Fabulous, yes.
A lot of actors actors who've been in the business for a while try to do side projects and, you know, entrepreneur and other things. Do you have any other side projects other than acting? Smack me butts.
If you don't follow me online, then do you? My sister and I write the Malcolm Merlyn Dark Archer comic book for DC. My sister and I also have been asked by Titan Comics and BBC Worldwide. We are recreating the new Torchwood, which is ready to go on television when it's time. We've also written 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I think 6 or 7 novels together. We've got 3 more to come out. And it's a series of YA novels called Hollow Earth. The new one is Conjurer. And Conjurer went into at number 7 in the bestseller list in the UK, YA novels. Side businesses, I have a production company, and also Kelsey and I have a management company, and I have a real estate business that we rent a lot of properties, and Scott and I, Scott's an architect, and we revamp them. We're kind of like, actually, that would be a great show. HGTV, Scott and I flipping houses, and Flipper Flop brings whole new meaning to it, right? We call it Gay Flipper Flop. Who's flipping tonight? Not me. I'm flopping. So we got that. And what else do we do? I love cars. I have a passion for, I'm a gearhead. And that doesn't mean drugs. There's lots of stuff. I also have a huge, vast collection of memorabilia and toys, which takes up a 2-car garage in my house. Yep, and I love it. How long do we have? 5 minutes. That's it. I gotta stop in 5 minutes, yeah. She's really firm, this one. Staph infection, you got it, girl. Thank you. Quick question. Go.
Hi,
Quick question.
If you could play any of the comic book character, who would you play?
None. I love Malcolm Merlyn and I love Captain Jack, and if they write a new one, then I'll do it. Thank you. Yes!
First off,
I'd like to play Wonder Woman. Okay. A gender-bending Wonder Woman. That would be awesome. Yes.
Real quick, I have to say your huge inspiration why I went to theater school. But my question for you is, what was the most emotional episode of Torchwood to film? Because Bianco? All I can think about that.
Well, that wasn't the most emotional for me. We were happy to see him go. Oh! I'm kidding! It was probably the sequence where each of them died. When Tosh and Owen died, we had to pack their stuff away. That was an emotional bit. And I watched that the other day in the plane. And also when Yanto died, but I was watching it on the plane, and I was sitting and watching it, and the girl behind me, I could feel her looking over my shoulder, watching it on my screen. And I got up and I stood up afterwards and the flight, and, you know, as you get up, everybody gets up when they get to the gate and you're not ready to get off, but everyone's freaking standing. And I stood up and I'm like this because I'm by the window. She taps me on the shoulder, she says, "Are you a Torchwood fan?" And I went, "Yes." And she went, "Ah!" Love my life. She pissed her pants right there on the plane. It was awesome. I felt sorry for the person who was coming on to sit in her seat because they had to take that cushion off. It was wicked. And she's like, "I can't believe it." I'm like, "Yeah, I felt you over my shoulder. I'm good at that." So yeah, those were emotional bits. And Yanto's death, obviously very emotional. Last question. You'll give me the total cutoff, yeah? Yeah.
First, we wanted to congratulate you. We saw you about 3 years ago in Detroit when they didn't believe you could fill a room. And you filled the biggest room in this comic. In this convention today.
Got it.
Congratulations.
Hey, I know I can fill a room. Trust me.
All right, and I just want to say that I am a trans man, and I so appreciate you because...
You're a man.
Yes. Well, that, and...
I know.
You are not a masculine man, and... Okay, that came out wrong, but you, I mean...
Let him speak. I get it.
I apologize.
I'm so not having sex with you either. No. Go ahead.
But you encouraged me to be myself.
Good.
I appreciate you 100%.
I totally get what you're saying.
Huge inspiration. So I love you, and I.
Thank you very much. As much as we're joking, I totally get what you're saying. It's a funny thing that I did a TV show, I can't say what, and the person came into the house in Palm Springs and started speaking to me. And they looked around the house and they said, this is not what we expected. I said, what did you expect? He said, feather boas and like glitter balls. I'm like, wrong house. The persona I have outside is very different from the John that sits at home with Scott, although he would disagree with me. Yes, last one. Are we last one?
Everyone's got one question, so I'll make it quick.
Quick.
Malcolm Merlyn gets to go and be the big bad on any CW show, not just an Arrowverse show. Where do you go and why?
Supernatural. And I'll tell you why. The three boys, that's why.